So talk to me about how Metropolis got its start.
I was going to school in Madison, Wisconsin. Driving cab, and I'd spend all my free time, and even on shift time, I'd pull up on the curb, go to the cafes. And one day I had a cup of coffee, and it literally was my aha moment. I decided to professionally pursue coffee. Worked my way up through the ranks from barista through tasting training and management and so forth, and just worked a gazillion hours, loved it, every minute of it, treated it as an apprenticeship rather than as a job.
Well, it seems like you turn what you learned around and also offer sort of apprenticeships for your employees.
Yeah, everybody moves up. You know, we ask humility and curiosity. Meanwhile, my dad, who was, cut frame, Chef Trifus, who I own Metropolis with, was in Seattle. He was learning how to cup and how to roast, and talk all the time about coffee on the phone, like, oh man, blah, 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 how's mom? Yeah, whatever, blah, 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 how's Karen? Yeah, whatever, blah, 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 Karen's my wife. We made an impulse purchase of a coffee roaster. So we bought it, it took them about 3 months to make it, and we stored it under the claw of the traveling Sue the dinosaur from the Field Museum. That was the only storage that was tall enough, so they literally stored our coffee roaster with the hopper sitting under Sue's crazy claws. Basically the way that it works is there's a hopper up top, and then we drop the coffee into the drum using that lever, which opens a flap, and the drum spins, and then there's paddles in the drum, which kind of force the coffee forward against the door and then back toward the back of the drum. So it's flowing like this as it's turning and being dumped up and down. Then we can see what's going on in the roast with the sample trier where we can pull beans out. Sean's working on the 15 kilo batch right now, and he's right at the very end. He's listening to the coffee.
What exactly would he be listening for?
The coffee opens up during the final stages of the roast, and it cracks.
Perfect.
So that's it. That's how we roast the coffee. We cool it in about 3 or 4 minutes, and then we run it through this destoner, which is really a density separator.
So it takes the
stones out, the glass, the bullet casings, as it were, all kinds of stuff in coffee. And then it goes straight over to production where we bag it up. All the coffee is roasted to order. It's all roasted yesterday, what you get today.
Perfect. So. How do you pick what types of coffee that you carry?
We're looking for seasonality. So coffee is harvested at different times of the year. Typically, we'll see those coffees about 3 to 4 months after they're harvested. We're gonna start getting into like Panamas and Guatemalas and Costa Ricas, and as well as Kenyas and Ethiopias. We're looking for coffees that when we evaluate them through cupping, that really perform incredibly well and interestingly on the cupping table.
The idea with slurping is, it's kind of like wine tasting. It's meant to aerate your palate.
We find the best coffees that we can find, and the relationship has to be sustainable. There can't be any abuse of the land or of the people. We're also really cognizant of the fact that we don't want too much influence over the way that growers are growing. One thing that we love about coffee is that a Sumatra tastes like a Sumatra, or a Kenya tastes like a Kenya, instead of they all taste like Metropolis coffee.
You guys don't do dark roasts.
We do not, no. It's always been a part of our mission to try to highlight the thing in itself, and we realized that we weren't really doing that with dark roast. We were highlighting a roast, but it wasn't the coffee that we were highlighting. So
sure.
We made a decision that we weren't being true to our mission.
One of the things that actually is really interesting about this place is that you guys actually use it for not just for coffee roasting. Yeah. You've had events here, you have bands practice here and stuff like that.
We all have lives, we all have interests. We want to help support that through the arts, primarily. We also work quite a bit with the local elementary school and do a couple of events a year for them. But the community supports us, we support them, and then also this is a place for us to explore our own interests. Sure. Playing music, you know, we have spray paint art here and there, you know, my dad rides a scooter around or whatever. But I think it really comes down to the idea that we're a part of a community and, you know, it, more than just from in a financial way. The community is made up of all these different people that have all of these different interests, and there are not really that many venues that can support that kind of thing. Coffee, in many ways, is a lifestyle choice.
Did you think when you were driving that cab around, enjoying cup after cup of coffee, that this would be the end result?
No way. I thought I'd have a little cafe tucked away somewhere, see a few customers a day.
It probably feels pretty good.
Yeah. That's awesome.
This has been fantastic. Thanks so much, Tony.
All right, Fez.
Appreciate
Thank you.
It.